Massive stone towers pierce an empty sky. This enormous structure is called the Cage. In its shadow, a lone girl walks with purpose. And she will not leave until she has what she desires.
Thank you.
Oh dear. So you did lose your voice after all. Don't worry. Mama's here to help. This way. You've lost more than just your voice. But I'm sure you already know that, don't you? You've lost so much, but the time has come to reclaim it. Life will be much harder if you can't speak, after all. These stairs are the entrance to your prison, a place known as the Cage. It's a truly massive structure. Where you woke up, and this sandy area here, are just small parts of it.
This place is called the Cage?
And now, the moment you've been waiting for, dream time!
How annoying.
We all live under someone else's command. Our bodies and emotions are not free. One often lacks the will to choose from the remaining options.
These feelings, they're all real. But my reality wasn't. I just wanted happiness. Normal happiness.
Truest meaning of the word never existed to begin with.
We don't have time to deal with gods right now.
I am a different man now.
It's something I want to do.
I won't stop until I've destroyed them all. Sear this into your mind.
I can destroy the flowers with this.
What is your anger meant for?
I'll kill them all.
Let's go. We have a final fragment to reclaim. Goodness, look at these rivers of sand. I wonder how such a thing came to pass. Make sure you don't get any grit in your eyes. I wonder where all of this sand is going. Let's head for the shiny black light up there. Statues are scattered throughout the cage. I don't know who made them, but I call them dark scarecrows. Anyway, this is the first one, so we'll start here.
A taciturn man follows. The boy proceeds uneasily, his eyes constantly probing for surroundings, almost as if he fears they are being followed. Suddenly, a dreary town emerges from the dust. The boy suggests they take their rest, and the man nods silently. To make for a nearby eatery, hoping to shake the road from their weary bones. But instead of welcome, they find a group of bounty hunters gathered at their destination. The lead hunter stares at the child, appraising him. "You royalty, boy?" His voice is wrath. The boy remains silent, his head hanging low. Angered by the lack of response, the bounty hunter suddenly draws his gun. Two shots ring out and fade into the dusk.
Did you see the flock of black birds that possessed the bounty hunter? They're nasty sorts who like to fly in and warp the story. Well, we are not going to let that stand, are we? Your role is to defeat them and put the story back the way it's supposed to be. But I suppose you already know that, don't you?
Perhaps angered by the lack of response, the bounty hunter suddenly draws his gun. I shall take care of them.
Counter initiated.
Take their leave of the town. The man silently nods and gazes upon the boy's face.
Warped memories like this in order to restore complete stories. But we also need to collect weapons like these. Do you have a rough sense of what you're supposed to do now, child? Yes, I suppose it is a lot to wrap your mind around. It'll make sense as we find more stories. Don't be afraid to ask for help. To construct something so large. You will sometimes encounter black birds in the cage. And you should do what you can to shoo them all out. If you do that, Mama will give you a nice surprise. Opening the menu already, are we? Mama was planning to give you an explanation later. Are you sure you want to fiddle with it now? So impatient! Sadly, all I can let you do right now is summon. I can't even permit you to use any of the things you've obtained so far. Are you still sure you want to open the menu? Goodness, you're not giving Mama much of a choice here. Here's the second one. Are you ready?
Wherever people gather, stories come with them. But saloons have a special ability to loosen even the tightest of lips. Such rumors or what brings the woman with the mechanical arm and leg to this place. For she is a bounty hunter in search of her prey. The information she obtains from the patron seems vague, but it is more than enough. Gathering herself, she exits the saloon in pursuit of her target. A pair of tiny beads. Give me all your money, he howls.
I'll cut down everything in my way. We won't lose.
It is over in a moment. The woman's sigh is carried off by the wind. No mediocre highwayman could hope to stand against her desire for revenge. The woman heads for the forest in pursuit of her target.
We collect stories in order to regain what you have lost. But we also do it to make your wish come true. So let's keep it up. Slow and steady wins this race.
Thank you.
I should tell you a little bit about the cage. It's a truly massive structure. Where you woke up, and this sandy area here, are just small parts of it. To be honest, a great deal of the cage is a mystery. I'm not even certain who gave it that name.
Here he is searching for food. The expression on his bandaged face is clouded. The grasses rustle ominously as they part. It seems the man is not the only one searching for food. The animals in this place are lean, starving, desperate. They will do what they must to survive.
Enemy forces sighted.
Thank you.
having secured his prize, the man returns to the church. The sound of his worn boot heels echoes throughout the dilapidated chapel. A boy lies at the back, his face drawn and haggard. The man kneels down and offers some of the food he collected. But the boy is too weak to hold it. His body will not allow him to accept even this meager meal. The boy tries to brush it off with a feeble smile, but the man just stares down at him in silence.
To think that poor sick child had to travel the wastes in his condition. Still, we've restored the third memory now. If we can collect the next one, it will mark the end of the staff's tale. Goodness, this place is nothing but stairs. I hope your little legs are okay. Still, I suppose it does allow us to see some rather lovely views. Be sure to rest whenever you start to feel tired, child. Someone once said resting is the shortcut to success, after all. It's so bright here. Ah, there's the fourth one. We should be able to enter the final memory here. People who arm themselves tend to find their way into a fight. I fear you will have to face a good deal of death from now on. Are you ready?
The woman who set out from town finally arrives at a wild wood. Soon, she comes across the ruins of a once proud church. The ceiling is collapsed, the walls are mere suggestions. Very back of the church, she finds a deteriorated clockwork soldier, as well as the corpse of a boy. As the woman approaches, the clockwork soldier suddenly rises. He levels his weapon at her and lets fly with a fearsome howl.
I'll cut down everything in my way.
Ah!
The woman accesses the logs of the fallen soldier. Boy was a prince, driven from his kingdom. The clockwork soldier traveling with him was his guardian and his friend. But alas, the boy's disease worsened and he perished. Not alone, the man remained behind and continued to safeguard his charge, killing any who dare approach the body. For 100 years, the man stood watch. Their kingdom fallen. His body, rust. His mind, shadow. Yet still he remained to protect his friend. The woman built a grave to mourn the pair, and leaves the forest without a word.
Before breaking down, the machine tried so hard to guard his master's body. This memory marks the end of the story they left behind inside this staff. Well done, child. Do you see how the proper story is now stored inside the staff? The lost fragment. Up the stairs now. We still have a long way to go. You have a long road ahead of you, so you'll need to increase your power. Where should I start? First, you need to arrange your allies in a loadout. Actually, it would be much easier to explain in a demonstration. It's mostly the same as any other game. Well done. You can also enhance allies and weapons, but... Oh, never mind. Just take a peek whenever you feel like it. Let's keep moving. The road splits here. Mama thinks we should go right, because it's the right way. But left also might be the right way. If it wasn't clear by now, Mama doesn't actually know. Started on its restoration, shall we? I wonder what kind of story we'll find this time. Sisters with lovely ebon hair lived in a lush and verdant land. They hunted for food in the forest and did their best to each support the other. Been born in the woods and was an archer of rare skill. When their parents died, she began teaching the younger how to hunt. The younger looks up to her and wants so badly to test out her new skills. This thought fills the older sister with warmth as she follows after her sibling. Suddenly, the elder sibling hears a beast cry out from the direction of her little sister. She sets off after her at a frantic pace. The savage beast looms over the prone girl and makes to attack. I'll cut down everything in my way. We'll be right back. As an arrow penetrates the beast's tender flesh, it turns tail and flees. There was no way her little sister could have taken down the massive creature alone. Trying to calm her, the woman removes her silver hairpin and places it on her sister. It is a keepsake of their mother, one the young girl has long desired. "Thanks, sis," she says, beaming. "Next time, it'll be my turn to protect you."
I shall take care of them.
Evade.
Ah!
the enemy be acting outside of the scarecrows? Well, let's just square them away as best we can as we go forward, okay?
I shall take care of them.
I've got enough death for everyone.
My turn!
Those dark creatures be after. I'm sorry, child. There are just so many things that Mama doesn't know. Look, something's out there. Could it be? There are so many mysteries in the cage, aren't there? This second scarecrow will hold another part of the weapon's memory.
Done with their hunting, the black-haired sisters decide to return home before dusk. The younger has caught a small bunny, and the elder a large boar. It is a typical day of hunting for the pair. To the hill that overlooks the town. Flames billow forth, and the chilling snaps of distant gunfire can be heard. The woman immediately thinks of the war that is raging in the neighboring nation. She tells her sister to stay put and goes to see what has happened for herself. The town is oddly still, save for the incessant crackle of flames. The woman gasps as she takes in the grisly sight before her. All she can see are bodies. Bodies. Bodies.
I shall take care of them.
I've got enough death for everyone.
Defeating the soldier, she hears a voice. Her worried sister has followed her into the fires of the village. Enemy soldiers cry out all around them. As the woman feared, the war from the nearby nation has finally found them. Strange and fearsome men surround them on all sides. Impact. Heat. Pain. Her little sister screams. As the woman's consciousness flickers out, two words from a soldier reach her ears. Sort them.
I see. This weapon speaks of war. I suppose it's rare for the memories in these weapons to be peaceful ones. That's a little sad.
I'll cut down everything in my way.
Thank you.
continuing mission.
I shall take care of them.
I've got enough death for everyone.
This room is a bit strange, isn't it? Can you see down there? There are so many paths going every which way. It's like a maze. I wonder where the other paths lead.
Thank you.
The black-haired woman regains consciousness in a world enveloped by haze. She hears a faint voice. It sounds similar to her little sister's voice, but also different. Wrong. My sister. I have to save my sister. The woman's dim memories slowly become clear. The blow she'd taken, her sister screaming, the soldier's words. Her only sister, her only family. She must save her. As she runs, the woman's world is enveloped in a shimmering wall of white. When the woman wakes anew, she is lying on the floor of an unfamiliar prison. Something is terribly wrong. She looks down at her body and stifles a gasp. One arm and one leg have been replaced by mechanical substitutes. And her black hair is now as white as snow. Where is my sister? She dashes off through the dim prison in search of her missing sibling. She dispatches both her cell door and its guard with equal ease. Only then does she realize the truth. Her body is now a terrible weapon. As this knowledge sinks in, darkness envelops her.
I'm not afraid.
Enough death for everyone.
More. More!
When she interrogates the dying guard about her sister, he grins madly and says, "Our kingdom will invade all. Every country will bend the knee to our might. Then we'll experiment on the survivors and turn them into beautiful killing machines. Oh yes, they will be sorted. With these final words, the soldier dies. The woman begins to run. Don't think about it. Don't think about it. Don't think about it. She repeats the mantra as she runs, praying that somehow her sister has escaped this fate. Thank you.
the woman in this weapon. She lost her arm and leg because of her dark past.
I'm not afraid.
I've got enough death for everyone.
I'm not afraid.
I have no time for this.
Kill them all.
What? That was... Looks like that monster ran off somewhere. Anyway, the next memory we find will be the last for this part of the cage. We're almost there, child. Just keep going.
As the woman exits her prison, she beholds a town stained red with both flame and blood. She is in a strange land, one she does not recognize. But she must find her sister. The woman runs and runs and runs.
I'm not afraid.
I've got enough death for everyone.
She dashes toward the sound. The thing standing before her was once her sister. But now, all trace of her former self has been lost to the sorting.
I shall take care of them.
Her transformed little sister trembles, as if trying to remember something. The moment her sister is cut down in front of her, the woman loses all control. Even when her enemies are no more than mangled hunks of flesh, she cannot stop. Finally, the woman cradles her sister in her arms and gazes at her blood-stained face. Their hair, once dark as night itself, was now pure white. Yet the hairpin still glinted from atop the sister's head. The woman was alone, her fate was sealed, and so she swore a vow to her sister. The fires of her revenge would rage until they consumed the entire kingdom. People need goals and hopes in order to live their lives. And for her, revenge was itself a form of hope. Desire and the drive to move forward. There are still many things you need to reclaim. Come now. The next fragment is waiting for you.